गुड क्लिनिकल प्रैक्टिस और इन शॉर्ट वी से जीसीपी। सो दीज आर द गाइडलाइंस प्रोवाइडेड बाय द आईसीएच इन ऑर्डर टू एंश्योर द क्रेडिबिलिटी एंड रिलायबिलिटी ऑफ इंफॉर्मेशन दैट वी ऑब्टेन बाय कंडक्टिंग द क्लिनिकल ट्रायल्स। ओके, सो फार वी हैव ऑलरेडी स्टडीड अबाउट व्हाट आर द क्लिनिकल ट्रायल्स, व्हाट आर द डिफरेंट फेजेस ऑफ क्लिनिकल ट्रायल्स। सो दिस जीसीपी गाइडलाइंस दे इंश्योर दैट इफ सर्टन प्रोसीजर्स, सर्टन रूल्स एंड रेगुलेशंस, if they are followed while conducting the clinical trials, then they ensure that whatever data we obtain from the clinical trial studies, it is of credible nature. That means you can believe it. Okay, you can trust the data. Okay, unless and until you trust the data, there is no point of obtaining the data. Okay, so data should be trusted. Okay. So it should be published and it should be generated. Okay. So what are the objectives of today's presentation? Is that we have to define the what are good clinical practice. Then we have to outline the goals of the GCP. Then we have to provide a historical perspective on GCP, that how different historical events that constructed the GCP guidelines or that help in formation of basis for the GCP guidelines. Okay, the next is you should be able to outline different FDA regulations relating to the GCP in the medical device research. Okay, so next is, let's see what is GCP guidelines. So GCP is defined as a standard for design, conduct, performance, monitoring and auditing, recording, analysis and reporting of clinical trials or studies. So what it includes, it helps in design, conduct, performance, monitoring, auditing, recording, analysis and reporting. Okay, so all of these things associated with the clinical trials, they are standard to it is provided by the GCP. Okay, so additional terms which are defined over here, that is clinical investigation, clinical investigator, human subject, institutional review board. So clinical investigation means what? If in a clinical trial you are trying to find out that the mechanism of action of oral hypoglycemic agent, or let's assume that some other type of drug, that is antihypertensive drug. So the type of investigation which you will carry out using the human subjects, that will be the clinical investigation. Okay, so the clinical investigation must include the human subjects and it must include the some kind of new drug entity. Okay, so clinical investigator is the one who is involved in the clinical investigation. So clinical investigator, it may be a pharmacist, the paramedical staff, then the doctors, they are all part of this terminology, that is clinical investigator. So human subjects, so these are if depends on the phase of the clinical trial. The human subject may be healthy volunteer or it may be diseased volunteer. Okay, so healthy volunteer in case of phase 1 and phase 2 onwards, these are the diseased population. Okay, then institutional review board. So this is locally constituted a review board in the institution where the clinical trials are being conducted, and this institutional review board reviews the all the procedures and the ethical guidelines which are given by the GCP, whether they are followed during the clinical trials or not. Okay, so they take the periodic review of the things that goes on in the clinical trial. The next is why GCP is important. So GCP compliance provides public assurance that it provides a trust to the public that the rights, safety, and well-being of human subjects involved in the research are protected. So what are the three things? That is the rights. Okay, so every human has the right to take part in the clinical trial or leave the clinical trial. So this GCP ensures that the rights of the human being, they are protected. Also, they ensure that whoever participates in the clinical trial, the safety of them is ensured by these GCP guidelines. Okay, so the investigator needs to take care of the safety of the human volunteers who take part in the clinical trials. Okay, and also well-being of the human subjects is ensured by the GCP guidelines. Okay, one second. So what are the goals of GCP? So first goal of GCP is to protect the rights, safety, and welfare of human participating in a research. So this is we have already covered in last slide. Second goal of GCP is to assure quality, reliability, and integrity of data collected. Okay, so if data which is being collected after spending a lot of money in the clinical trials, if it is not of certain quality, if it is not of certain reliability, if it is not of certain reproducibility value, then such data is worthless. Okay, so if the GCP guidelines are followed, then it ensures that whatever data we get, it is of a certain quality, it is of a certain credibility, it is of certain reproducibility value. Okay, so third goal of GCP is to provide standards and guidelines for the conduct of the clinical research. So it is like standard operating procedure which is governs the clinical research. Okay, so how to, if you are totally unknown about how to conduct clinical trials, then you have to refer to these guidelines so that it provides us the outline to the clinical research, and by following that particular outline you can conduct your clinical research. So this good clinical practice, so it is equal to nothing but ethics and the quality data. Okay, so GCP is equal to ethics plus quality data. So just wait a second. So what are the foundations of the ethical conduct of the clinical research? So how this GCP guideline, they came into the picture. So what, why we needed the GCP guidelines so badly to ensure the ethical, to address the ethical issues of the clinical trials, and also to ensure the data which we get from the clinical research, it is of certain value. Okay, so there were certain incidences in the history that dictated us to go for the GCP guideline formation. Okay, so these incidences, they are named here, and we have already discussed what are those. Okay, so let's not make a very detailed presentation about it. So first one is the Nuremberg Code, then second is Declaration of Helsinki, third one is the Belmont Report. In see the timeline, in 1947 it is Nuremberg Code, in 1964 it is Declaration of Helsinki, then Belmont Report it is in the 1979, Then comes the International Conference on Harmonization, so that is ICH GCP. So exact form of the GCP guidelines is given by this, that is International Conference on Harmonization. And keeping these guidelines in mind, the other guidelines they have derived from this. Okay, so this is like golden standard of the GCP guidelines, and other guidelines with smaller deviation depending on the local situations, the other GCP guidelines they are developed. Okay, then next is the International Standard Organization, so it is ISO 14155. So this is the guideline number of ISO standard which is concerned with the clinical research. Okay, then next, lastly, that is Code of Federal Regulation. So we have already seen one of it, that is CFR 21 chapter 312. Okay, 21 CFR 312, that is the part of it. Okay, that deals with the new drug application. Okay, so quick review of the things, that is Nuremberg Code. So voluntary participation, it says, then it introduces the concept of informed consent, and also it is concerned with the minimization of risk. Then Declaration of Helsinki, so it talks about well-being of subject takes precedence. Okay, so respect for the persons is what Helsinki Declaration of Helsinki says. Then protection of subjects' health and the rights, and a special protection for vulnerable population. So if you see the Nuremberg Code and the Declaration of Helsinki, both they talk about the ethics. Okay, so they don't exactly talk about the quality of data which is to be obtained from the clinical research, but they focus on this part, that is ethics, because whatever incidences that preceded this Declaration of Helsinki and the Nuremberg Code, they all the ethical guidelines or all type of ethics, they were not present in those clinical studies. That's why they focused on this point, that is ethics. So they are like a foundation stone to the ethics part of the good clinical practices guideline. Okay, so next is the Belmont report. Again, it talks about the ethical principle. So respect for the persons. Okay, so informed consent, again it is strengthened in Belmont report. Then protection of vulnerable population, the thing which is being talked in the Declaration of Helsinki, again this mention of the same happens in the Belmont report. Then second is the beneficence, so non-maleficence should be there, that is no harm, do no harm. And lastly, it talks about justice. Okay, so everyone should be treated fairly. Okay, so there should not be a bias on part of investigator while recruiting the subjects into the clinical trial. So various designs of the clinical trial are there. So one of the design is a randomized controlled clinical trial. Okay, so randomization concept, it comes from this Belmont report. The next, International Conference on Harmonization, that is ICH, it has given GCP guidelines, and the GCP is an international quality standard. So as it is this International Conference on Harmonization, it is an international entity, the guidelines which are given by it, they have the international recognition, and also they are of international quality standard which is provided by ICH. Okay, so the goals of this ICH GCP guidelines are to harmonize technical procedures and standards, And second goal is to improve quality, and third goal is to speed time to market. Okay, so it talks about three things. That is, first, to harmonize technical procedure and the standards. That is, it help in standardization of various technical procedures, and also it provided some standards to the procedures. So all over the world, internationally, whatever procedures which are being followed in order to conduct the clinical research, they have certain standards and they follow certain technical procedures. Okay, in 1997, the FDA endorsed the GCP guidelines. So before to 1997, these GCP guidelines were introduced, but in 1997, the FDA accepted them and they endorsed the GCP guidelines developed by the ICH. So ICH guidelines have been adopted into law in several countries, but used as guidance for FDA in form of GCP. Okay, so next is, okay, so there are 13 principles which are mentioned in the ICH GCP guidelines, and these 13 principles, they are divided into various subheadings. So the first subheading is the ethics. Okay, so in under ethics, there are three. That is, first is ethical conduct of the clinical trials. Okay, so whatever clinical trials are to be conducted, they are to be conducted keeping in view the ethical problems which are associated with the clinical trials. Okay, so second principle it mentioned is that benefits justify the risk. That means the benefits should outweigh the risk. Okay, so third principle is the rights, safety and well-being of the subjects prevail. Okay, so whatever clinical procedures are to be carried out, they are to be carried out keeping in mind that the subjects, human subjects, they have certain rights. Also, while carrying out these clinical procedures, we have to take utmost care of the safety and well-being of the subjects, and we have to keep the right safety and well-being of the subjects before any of the clinical procedures which are to be conducted during clinical trials. Okay, so the procedures won't come first, the right safety and well-being of the subjects, they will come first, and they will always precede whatever the procedures of the clinical trials. Then second subheading is the protocols and science. Okay, so non-clinical and clinical information supports the trial. Okay, so it should have certain scientific basis to carry out the clinical trials. Okay, so when we say non-clinical, we must have sufficient animal data in order to support the clinical trial study, and also at the same time we should have certain clinical information to in order to conduct the clinical trial studies. Then next is compliance with scientifically sound and detailed protocol. So whenever we will design a protocol to conduct a clinical trial study and submit it to the institutional review board, that protocol should have the contents, should have the data which is scientifically proven. Any scientifically not proven study design, it won't be included into the protocol. Everything in the protocol should have certain scientific basis or scientific proof backing it. Okay. So next is responsibilities. So sixth principle is IRB or IEC, Institutional Ethics Committee, Institutional Review Board, okay, approval prior to the initiation. So before we begin for any clinical trial study, we have to take permission from the IRB or IEC. Okay. Then medical care or decisions by qualified physicians. Okay. So qualified physicians must be the part of the clinical trial, and they must take all the medical care decisions related to the clinical trials. Okay. Then eighth principle is that each individual is qualified to perform his or her task. So all the stakeholders of the clinical trials except the human volunteers or human subjects should have certain educational qualification and experience to take part in the clinical trials. Then next subheading is the informed consent. So ninth principle of the ICAGCP says that the informed consent must be freely given from every subject prior to the participation. So we should not include any subject who has not given the informed consent. Okay, so before we start recruiting the human subjects into the clinical trials, the investigator needs to detail each and every individual about risk and benefits of the drug which is under clinical research. Okay, so once the patient understands that all the information, the investigator must get the informed consent signed from the participant. There should not be use of any kind of coercion methods in order to take benefits of the vulnerabilities of the participants, so that participants by not free will give the informed consent to the investigator. The important thing over here, it is freely given. That means under any undue under any forceful condition, the consent should be given by the patient to the investigator. The next subheading is the data quality and the integrity. And the 10th principle under ICH is that accurate reporting, interpretation and the verification of the data is a must. Okay, so we say it is accurate reporting. So whenever whatever data which is obtained from the clinical trials, accurately we have to report the data as it is. We should not manipulate, we should not do any changes in the data that is obtained from the clinical research. Okay, the next 11th principle says that the data quality and under data quality and integrity that protects the confidentiality of records. Okay, so a confidentiality agreement should be there that whatever data is generated, that we have to keep it confidential till the submission of the data to the FDA. Okay, the next subheading is the investigational products. So 12th principle says that conform to the GMPs, that is good manufacturing products, good manufacturing practices and use per protocol. Okay, the next is quality control and quality assurance. So the systems with the procedures to ensure quality of every aspect of the trial. So quality control and quality assurance system should be there in place in order to ensure the whatever procedures are being carried out, whatever things are being carried out in the clinical trials, they are of certain quality. Okay, so any deviation from the procedure should be rectified at that particular time only. Okay, so ISO, that is International Standards Organization, it has given one particular guideline that deals with the clinical trial research or the clinical research organization. They need to get this ISO certification. that is ISO certification number 14155. Okay, so it deals with the clinical investigation of the medical devices for human subjects. So it assists sponsors, monitors, and clinical investigators in the design and conduct of device clinical investigation. So it deals with the medical devices, not the medicines. Okay, so it assists regulatory bodies and ethics committees in their roles of reviewing clinical investigational plans. Okay, so what constitutes good clinical practice in device research? That is IRB approved protocol, then valid informed consent, the next is monitoring plan, then adverse device effects reporting, that is adverse event or serious adverse event, then proper documentation, and lastly the valid data collection or reporting procedures. Okay, so who is responsible for GCP compliance? So sponsors, clinical investigator, independent ethics committee, then IRB also is there under that, that is contract research organization, that is CROs, who actually conduct the clinical trials, then research nurses, clinical research coordinators, then clinical research associates, then medical monitors, then data entry personnel, and the others. Okay, so FDA, how it implements the GCP, that it has given in its code of federal regulation. So you can see in 21 CFR only you will find the things related to the GCP guidelines. So these are all the parts of it. So 21 CFR is common in all. So parts 11, 50, 54, 56, 812, 814. So 11, part 11, it deals with the electronic records and the signatures related to the GCP. Then part 50 deals with protection of human subject. Part 54 deals with financial disclosures. Then part 56 deals with institutional review boards. Part 812 deals with investigational device exemptions. And part 814 deals with pre-market approval of medical devices. Okay, so summary of everything that we have dealt with in our presentation is that we have defined the GCP, then we have outlined the goals of GCP, then we have presented a historical perspective on GCP, then we have outlined FDA regulations relating to the GCP in the medical device.